This year, so many of us have discovered that we need our gardens more than ever. So every week on this series, I'm delighted to invite you to my home so that we can go gardening together. So I'm clearing this area of the garden here because it's not working out as I planned anymore. I wanted to grow, and I did grow, fruit and veg. There's a nice big cherry tree, but the hedges have grown up around it, and hedges are very useful for privacy, for your neighbours and for yourself, and they cut down on noise. But for vegetables, you need as much sunlight as possible, and it gets a bit too shaded. But if I can't grow veg, what could I do with this space? I've decided I want to keep chickens. I've always wanted to keep chickens. And this area will be perfect. Like a lot of guys, I'm very challenging to buy a present for Bertha's. And this year, during lockdown, I told him exactly what I wanted. I wanted chickens. And I got a roast chicken and some eggs for my birthday. But I'm gonna have the last laugh. You'll see the results later, but first, many of you have been sending in your gardening questions, and I want to answer some of the more popular and some of the more unusual ones. When you buy a new house, you spent the first few years making decisions. Not garden decisions. You want the three-piece suite, you want the carpets, you want the curtains, you want the new kitchen. And then, Kira, you move outside and you want to build up the framework of the garden. And I think you're deciding on the main features, the main planted features of your garden. What would be your questions?
Yes, so we've just put a fence to the front of our house, so I would like some advice with regards to what trees we could plant there alongside that fence and the hedging as well. In particular, we have a small bed at the front of the house in direct eyesight with the front room. I would like some advice perhaps with a miniature tree to put there and some shrubs to go with that, please.
So, first of all, for hedging, is it an exposed place?
Yes, it is.
Is it very windy?
Yes, it's windy here.
Beech would be fantastic. Beech makes an absolutely beautiful hedge. It's not evergreen, but you do have foliage on it, mainly through the year, because it keeps its leaves right through the winter. For a nice tree, I know you like something like the oriental maple. I have one in this part of my garden in Dappleshade, growing really well, except that your site is a little bit more exposed. So if you like a weeping tree, don't go for a weeping willow. It takes too much water and it looks fairly dry there. So go for something like a weeping birch. And then under that, go for things like herbaceous geraniums that will flower from May right through to September, October, and some shrubs like the pittosporum, and it grows in low moundy shapes. So for colour, I'd have herbaceous geraniums. For shrubs, I would have low-growing pittosporums. And for a tree, a nice weeping birch.
Great, thank you so much.
Woohoo! You have to do that now too.
Woohoo!
Let's try it together. Woohoo! What are we like? Anne-Marie O'Donnell has a very interesting question. She moved into an old house last year, but during the winter, she really began to notice the huge amount of mosses and particularly lichen that's growing around the place. Is it doing any harm to the trees? And if so, how would she control it? Now, Colm works on Airfield Estate in Dundrum. So I think you'd be great for this question because I'm sure you've had the same issue.
The good news is that moss and lichens won't cause a tree any harm at all. However, it can often be an indicator of poor plant vigour. And it might be worth weeding the area around the tree and applying a mulch. But overall, it's more likely just to be a result of the environmental conditions. Personally, I actually like the effect mosses have on trees and shrubs, so I'd be in no rush to get rid of it. If anything, I'd embrace these conditions. Kokedama is a Japanese art of growing a moss ball with plants growing inside it, and they might be something worth growing on the branches of your tree. They'll also provide some winter interest to your tree during the dormant season.
I love designing gardens for families because every different age group has a different requirement. Now, there's one family in Howth in County Dublin, and they have four children, and they've just expanded their house, big extension off to the side. So they're dealing with leftover spaces.
Hello!
Hi, Suzanne, hello!
Hi!
It's the Brady Bunch.
We literally are, yes, the Von Trapp.
So you're gonna show me your garden?
Okay. So we're going out into the back patio area. Yeah. So this is the back garden.
That whole triangle gets the sun, and you have a pebble dash wall and then a block wall.
At the end, there's kind of a little platform where that is going.
I see a rabbit hutch.
Yeah, unfortunately, no rabbits, they escaped.
Oh, did they?
Yeah. And then we have kind of bamboo edging kind of here.
Yeah.
Along the edges, and there's Oren again in the picture. Then you walk around, and this wall is being rendered here and painted. This area here, which kind of connects into the kitchen.
Yes,
and this,
yes.
We kind of had an idea, maybe herb garden.
The extension was supposed to be about a 6-month job, but then the lockdown started when we were about 3 or 4 weeks away from the end of it.
Yeah.
But we still hadn't got a kitchen or heating or anything like that in, so everything came to a stop. So that added an extra 2 months on.
Two and a half months, mm. Yeah.
So we're finally getting back in now.
Now we have an awesome house, but as we can see, garden needs a little bit of work and TLC. Yeah. I think shape, like you've got shapes, you've got angles.
The space is awkward.
Yeah.
And it's kind of disconnected as well. So we've got this patch over here in the front of the garden, which is it's the bit that's left over when other things were done. And then we've got that big steep-walled alleyway going down the side of the house.
And then the triangly bit,
yeah.
So
it's bringing everything together. We knew it was a thorny problem that we'd have to come to at some stage, but it had been kind of pushed off until the end.
Yeah.
So.
We need help. It's a family space, so we don't want it to be like a manicured kind of lawn. We want it to be that it's for the kids, it's for us as well, so.
There's a lot of energy to get stuck into this.
So yeah. Harness the energy. We put them to work in the garden and we'll create an awesome family space.
Okay, could you line all the children up and tell them they have one sentence each to tell me what they want?
Right, okay.
Suzanne, this could be the biggest mistake I've ever made, could it? Oh, look at you. Aren't you a handsome bunch?
In the garden, I would like a bar to swing on and a willow, if it can fit anywhere.
A willow tree?
Yeah.
Why would you like a willow tree? A weeping willow?
Because I like willow trees.
That's a good enough reason.
I would really like a herb garden and a big trampoline.
Okay.
I would like some flowers, please.
You love colour and you love pollen for the bees and the butterflies.
I would like some fruit trees and maybe some strawberry plants.
Oh, very good. Okay. This is going to take a little bit of thought. Investment in good soil, in nice pots, in one trampoline and in time.
Okay.
Okay.
See you soon.
Thanks, bye.
Many of you are in the same situation, a garden that needs to strike the perfect balance between the needs of the children and the needs of the adults. Lots for me to think about. Loads of us aspire to that idea of living the good life. I'm not doing so well in that regard. But during lockdown, I came across a guy who is. Brian lives in the centre of Cork City, and he's created an urban farm.
The lockdown really focused the mindset. Food security, you know, it was a kind of an unknown situation, you know, whether we would have a supply of food. I have a company called Central Flower Supplies, and during the lockdown we had to close, obviously. So we're kind of on a second story building, and there's an industrial unit underneath us. And we were thinking of growing some vegetables, maybe some flowers, in a courtyard adjacent to my apartment. One evening we were out on the rooftop here looking out at it, and Ty suggested, you know, this space is bigger, it's more access, why don't we do it here?
When I saw the space, I thought, oh my God, we can grow a lot of vegetables. And then, voila.
It's kind of mind-blowing how 3 months ago this was a totally empty space. And what started off with a small intention to grow some food for ourselves quickly turned into something an awful lot bigger. We grew everything from seed in our polytunnel. We have about 25 different varieties of tomato, about 10 different varieties of chilies. We have potatoes, about 4 or 5 different types of lettuce. We've got beetroot, we've got parsley, chives, onions, leeks, squashes. There's a good bounty there, so we're eating like kings at the moment. And then we've chickens up here as well, which is totally crazy.
Chomp, 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 chomp.
But it adds a bit of character to the place, I think. Getting materials up here is a bit of a chore. We've had to get upwards of 40 bags of soil and compost. There's also benefits to being up high. We don't have any slugs or snails, which every gardener, I think, would envy. My main tips for people starting off would be really put an emphasis on your soil. Whatever you put into the soil, you'll get back tenfold, you know? If you have a smaller space, and you're trying to maximise it, often a good way is to go up. So growing things that will grow up a trellis or up a wall, runner beans, peas, aubergines will climb up trellising, so often you can get a bigger reap by using your vertical space. We had nothing here, it was a blank canvas as such when we started. It's been a barren rooftop space for 60 years. I think it's cool to transform it into something a bit more productive and vibrant, you know?
I've been out and I've taken some nettles. They're great to have in your garden. Always keep a few clumps growing because your butterflies will emerge from caterpillars that feed on them. I have a bucket with a lid. That's very important. So just an empty bucket. I'm going to get my nettles, put them in. Next, I'm simply going to fill this, not right to the very top. I'm going to put quite a bit of water in here. I'm using rainwater because rainwater hasn't had any chemical treatment. So the idea is to make a wonderful plant food out of that. So put the lid on, put it in a sunny place. Every few days, take off the lid, give it a stir. There'll be a chemical reaction in there. It'll be bubbling. In about 2 weeks, it'll stop bubbling. But the smell will be absolutely awful. Then you strain it through something like an old dishcloth or something like that. You'll have a solution. And in the grand old tradition of Blue Peter, here's one I made earlier. I prepared this about a month ago. I've strained it. It's ready for use. The way I would use it would be to dilute 1 part nettle soup to 10 parts water straight into your pots, your containers, your hanging baskets, a lot of your fruit and flowers and your shrubs. And there it is. And I have to say, the fumes coming from that straight away are absolutely lethal, but your plants will love it. Luckily, I've a clear mind and have had some creative thoughts on our family garden makeover. So the Hanway Wilbs here, they have a house that they've just extended into the garden, made lovely design decisions inside, but they've left a kind of patchwork of areas that need addressing. I don't think it needs an overall design. I think it needs a few techniques and lots of planting to melt the new garden in with the extended house. With ideas in mind for all three areas, including a herb garden out front, I've listened to every family member.
I've sent along my mate and project manager James to get work moving.
So I suppose, Suzanne, from the shape of the garden here to back, okay. It's quite small and it's triangular. So yeah. We're going to push the trampoline right back into that corner.
Yeah.
We'll roll out a turf lawn from that area at the front back to this curb that's along here.
I was really looking forward to having a trampoline and I wanted a herb garden too because I do a lot of cooking.
For the last week, it's been like chaos.
Peel off the loins.
Down anyway, you're going up too high.
Because of a mixed match of walls, a metal grid will run the whole length of the garden, creating a framework for climbing plants, resulting in a vertical garden.
You're talking, it's probably going to be this height.
Hello!
Hello!
Hi there, Mr.
How is progress?
Good.
Yeah,
a few dodgy weather days, but we've made good progress.
I can't wait to see what you've been at.
Sorry, this area has been tidied up now, so we have sleepers going along here.
So
the big hole that was here has been filled and we're getting the roots out now of those big bushes and trees that were up at the top.
So this is the area that really needs controlling. We want a beautiful herb garden, we want your fruit trees. So let's do an informal gravel pathway. And herbs will absolutely love growing through gravel because most of them are Mediterranean. They want good drainage at their base.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay, I'll leave you in the capable hands of James. I think you're doing exceptionally well there.
Okay.
Bye.
Talk to you very soon.
Bye.
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 Water is vital for gardeners. It's an incredibly important resource, and our weather patterns are changing. Often we're subject to many months of hosepipe bans during the summer. So when it does rain, it's a great idea to harvest the water. How do you do that? By getting a water bottle. What you need is a watertight container of any type. I'm using a repurposed oak barrel, which I found on the internet. You can buy plastic ones in shops. And what you do is attach them to a downpipe. Our roof spaces collect a huge amount of water. Generally, that's just lost into the drainage system. I've inserted a tap at the base of the barrel, and look at that lovely, fresh rainwater. Plants are gonna love this. It's chemical-free. It hasn't been treated in any way. And when there's a hosepipe ban on, this is what I use. I'm so excited because my chicken coop is soon to arrive in the garden. I've had this dream for a long time. 20 years ago, I talked to Dorina Allen about the ins and outs of keeping chickens with a garden. Never did anything about it, though. I am now. And do you know who's going to help me? Her daughter-in-law, Rachel Allen, because she has 350 of them.
Hey, Jan here to do the three-month cookery course from Dublin 30 years ago, and I saw lots and lots of chickens, and I just thought, oh, this is great. I love this. Talk about country living. Little did I know that I would become just surrounded by chickens. And this is one of my favourite parts of the whole farm. Just encased in this amazing old beach hedge is the herb garden. I'm going to pick some herbs to give us a little treat for the hens. Chickens they're really clever. You know, they will pick at herbs. There's some bay here, so I might get a few bay leaves. Apparently they do know what they're eating, and certain herbs will help with respiratory conditions, immune conditions. Some people say the herbs help to give the eggs flavor. I don't really think there's, you definitely don't get the flavor of rosemary or thyme or something from your eggs. Lemon balm, lovely. But you're bound to get goodness, you know, because of course what the hens are eating, the goodness is going to come out in the eggs. That'll be nice. I'm normally picking the herbs for myself. And really good freshly laid eggs are just so healthy, so good and so delicious to use. Let's see if they feel like some herbs. They might not. Look, here, chick, 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 chick. they don't want it. Look. That's the best part. So for someone starting off, you know, it could be an average-sized garden, but it could be a really small garden as well. 3 or 4 hens is a really nice amount for an average-sized family. If you want them to be ready for laying, they need to be about 6 months to about 3 years old. And they're much easier than you think. They really are. So this is the best bit, collecting your own eggs. Diarmuid, I'm sending these up to you. I hope you enjoy them, and I hope you have lots of fun with your own chickens.
This is a question from Maureen in Clondalkin. It's about roses, and she wants to know, can she take, as she says, a slip of a rose at this time of the year, or is there a better time of the year? You could take it, Maureen, now, or you could wait. Certainly a better time of the year in October, November, December, when the rose is pretty much dormant. Trish in Waterford writes to me, she's a problem with droopy plants. Trish, it's very, very simple. Spring was dry for so long, and it's just wilted. Quite simply, your lobelia is stressed. With water, it won't be anymore. It's like Christmas morning. I'm so excited about this. I've been waiting for 20 years. Hello! They're here. Oh, I have hens. So what we've done is to create a compound to the side of the house. We've made it very secure by these posts and railed with this wire. That's really important because I want to keep foxes out. I heard dreadful stories about foxes, but if we put them in at night, very secure. And I've planted it with a few ornamentals that are meant to be chicken-proof, but we'll see. Echinaceas and these Hemerocallis, the daylily, and hostas. I've got this chicken coop. You could make your own. Very simple, but this is really beautiful. It would cost about 400 to buy. On the ground, I've just spread out rough grey forest bark. They'll peck away at that. There's a cherry tree, and the fruits will drop as they ripen. I just love the sound that they bring to the garden, that sense of life that they bring to the garden. They're being rehoused from a factory farm situation. I've named them already. Arlene has gone inside. Then this one is Mary Lou. And Michelle is behind Mary Lou.
Ah, that's how that opens.
I have an egg. There's an egg.
It doesn't get better than this. It really is the good lad.
Thank you.
Weeks after starting their own garden project, have the Hanway Wills been able to finish in time?
Well, it's been chaotic.
It was tricky, it was busy, but it was fun, and I think it really pulled together kind of everyone, kind of family and friends, which is really, really nice. We kind of felt when we were really tight for everything that everyone really came
pulled
and helped
together,
and
yeah.
pulled in together, which was lovely. The trampoline was certainly...
There was a lot of digging.
Oh, God, there was a lot of digging. And Steve just wouldn't let us stop digging. It just went on and on.
The
never-ending hole.
It's all very Adam and Eve with these forbidden fruits. I have a mobile orchard that I'm about to bring to the Hanways. Well, look at all the planting, the railway sleepers. It all looks beautiful. It's done very well. Ah, the herb garden.
Here's a walking apple tree.
Wow, haven't you done a great job? Thank you. this is all great. You've done a fantastic job. I love the way that grid unifies everything. Look at the planting underneath the bamboo, all the climbers. I said to you that climbing plants can be a bit reluctant. They sit there for a couple of years, and then all of a sudden they explode. When they get going, it's just going to be a vertical garden, a green wall everywhere.
I'm really bad at visualising, so when Diarmuid and everyone was describing stuff, I was like, oh, how's that going to look? And now to see it, I think it really works. So I've had wanted lots of flowers. Fiona had wanted fruit trees.
Yeah.
We had wanted low maintenance, and I think it is. It feels like it'll be manageable.
I think so, yeah.
I hope so. Mm.
Look what you have. You've shrubs, you've grasses, jasmine. Oh, it's great. And a little forest of these multi-stem birch. They have a very interesting bark and the canopy of leaf floating above. And over here, of course, is the herb garden with the mint and the chives, the marjoram, the parsley. That is going to be lovely tumbling over this low wall. The currants that you have there, they'll grow so fast. And all the herbs on this side will grow so fast that you won't see any soil very, very soon. Filling a lot in some very awkward spaces.
So it was a combination of, we had an amazing builder, we had amazing friends and family, you know, our parents helped. So it was hard being out of the house, but then I think to come back, you know, get emotional, we get to come back, you know, and have...
Don't cry on TV.
To come back and have, the house and the garden at the same time is, yeah.
It's a joy.
It's really special.
I definitely think we'll use the garden more now. It's transformed into a beautiful space now, and I think we'll be sitting out a lot more.
Definitely.
So a huge transformation. I can see maybe a barbecue happening out here at the back, and then retiring at the front later on.
For cocktails at the front, yes.
I think they've done an amazing job. This garden was more about solutions to leftover spaces. The project was to unify all that, to bring some planting in, and to settle a trampoline in, to put a herb garden in, and a mini forest. There's been so many climbers put down here. They're going to create green walls or vertical gardens absolutely everywhere. Birch trees will look after themselves. I think all the Hanway wills have to do is enjoy it.